In the behavioral research program, we are interested in what causes people to smoke, what causes people to get screened or to not get screened for cancer, to use sunscreen to protect themselves from the sun, and various other behaviors.
It's not that we can just focus on one particular behavior as a way of preventing cancer. Most people are familiar with the relationship between smoking and cancer prevention, but there are other factors that influence cancer prevention as well.
If we could get people to eat better, exercise more, stop smoking, we could actually prevent about 50% of cancers and a lot of other health issues.
We think of behavior quite broadly, the psychological, cognitive, affective factors that sort of drive your ability to engage or not engage in those behaviors.
There's a lot of work that's also done in just sort of the chronic disease management end of the spectrum. Adherence, how people sort of manage their disease, all of those are essentially behaviors. And so most of actually of medical care is behavioral in nature as well.
A lot of the big focus of behavioral research today is really on the influence of systems and environments. So multiple levels of influence on individual patients and decision making, on hospitals and communities. This is a bigger part of behavior research today.
We need to understand the family context, the organizational context, the environment. I'm not going to exercise, for example, if I live in an environment where exercise is not possible. I'm not going to get screened if it's not covered by my insurance. That's a key message of behavioral research these days, is to think about all the different levels.
You asked what is the future of behavioral research, and in my opinion, really is on big data, especially with the world of technology, and whether through mobile phones or something, we can deliver interventions or we can track people's behavior. And I think we just need to figure out how to harness those data, how to make them useful, and again, how to translate them into ways that affect people's behavior, so we can affect people's behavior in a very positive way.
I think a lot of research is going to look in the future at how to understand the electronic environment and how people's smartphones might be used actually to advance their health. People are using apps all the time now to facilitate diet and to facilitate weight loss and smoking cessation and all kinds of other behaviors. And it'll be interesting to track that over time. It's a whole new world that scientists really need to understand.
There are a number of areas in future direction for behavioral research. So not only understanding how we can address mechanisms of long-term behavior sustainability, but better understanding human dynamics, the influences of family and family environment, the relationships of the family home versus the larger external environment, the built environment around the home, and how social influences impact that. Those are areas where we've made some good ground in terms of our understanding, but remain with a lot of opportunities to continue to grow and develop.
We've for a very long time measured behavior primarily via self-report. You tell me that you smoke or you don't smoke, you tell me how much you diet or exercise, those sorts of things. We're increasingly becoming better at being able to sense those things passively. So the sensor technology is getting to the point where we can actually give people sensors that will tell us how much physical activity they've engaged in, how much sort of dietary intake they have, smoking behavior they've engaged in, those sorts of things, adherence to medications. And I think we just need to challenge ourselves as researchers to actually explore new methods and new approaches.
You know, we often think that the story of tobacco and health is old and done and we know everything we need to know, but that's really not the case. We have a proliferation of many new tobacco products. We have new federal authority through the Food and Drug Administration to regulate tobacco marketing, manufacturing, and distribution. And so there's quite a bit of opportunity to look at how these factors are going to influence both youth and adults' tobacco use behaviors.
The field of survivorship has matured to a point where we're now having cohorts of survivors that are surviving 20, 30, 40 years. And so I think we're just at the brink of understanding the long-term unintended consequences.
It's really important, I think, for the graduate education model to change in a way that really teaches new PhD students how the work that they do potentially could be relevant and how to make it relevant from the outset, from a public health point of view. So I'm going to do the study. That what's going to happen if it actually pans out and works and the hypothesis works out? Can it be something that can be scaled up to a population level? That's something that behavioral researchers don't typically get trained to think about, but if they do, they can have more of an impact on public health.